Good morning, and welcome to church this morning. It's good to be here, and it's good to see all of you. And if you are worshiping with us online, we are delighted to have you with us as well. However you're with us, we're glad you're here. I was looking through the bulletin, and I noticed normally when we get up here to do the welcome, we do announcements, but lately we haven't been doing any. But today, I'm going to make just a little plug, because the Chosen, it's the first announcement up here. We have been watching those at home, and I have to tell you, if you have not been watching those, you are missing out. I have to confess that I was a little bit skeptical when I heard about it, because sometimes those shows aren't always well done, but these have really ministered to my heart. So if you have not been watching those, I encourage you to do that and to participate in the Zoom conversations. Last night we watched the one with Jesus just kind of talking with the children and interacting with children, and it was just made Jesus seem so real and so just, it was just really good. So anyway, I want to encourage that. And now if you will just take a minute and let's open our time of worship with prayer. Lord, we are here today, and we come here with so many different things. We come here with a mixture of joy, with anxieties, with concerns, with love. And Lord, we just pray that we will allow we want your spirit to fill us up. We want to be filled with all of the things that you promise that your believer, your followers will be filled with love and joy. We want to be filled with patience and goodness and faithfulness and self-control, all of these things, Lord. We just pray that you would come and fill us up so that when we hear about how Jesus interacted with people, we will be able to do that too. We want to love people the way you have loved them. So we just ask this. We ask that your spirit would convict us, that your spirit would fill us up, that you would inform the decisions that we make. And we just pray especially for us to be, especially, we know that you're here, but help us just to be ever aware of your presence and to allow you to lead and guide us. Thank you, Lord, for this hour, this time to just set aside things and to come together as a community to focus on you, to worship you, to lift you up. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. remember the first time somebody called me a disciple of Jesus. Yeah, disciple. Had a nice ring to it. It felt strong. You realized you were a part of something much bigger than yourself. Sometimes it was really, really tough. See, I can't begin to describe just how disorienting things were back then. I mean, one minute Jesus is telling you about the gift of life, and the next minute it seems like he's just gonna let us drown in the middle of the sea.
Spoiler alert, we didn't drown.
Sure seemed like we were going to. Looking back on it, I realized that Jesus didn't waste a moment. I mean, he was always showing us that he was who he said he was. Which, I know, begs the question, how can we doubt him? Yeah, I tend to be the one that gets asked that more than anybody, because for some reason, doubter has been connected with my name. For the record, I wasn't the only one who doubted. It's just, I wasn't there the day that Jesus appeared to everyone else. I was gone, and so I didn't, there, look, the finality of death, it has a choking grip on all of us. And on that day that Jesus was crucified, when death swallowed him up, and then there was the day that they showed me his hands and the scars, and he said, "Thomas, you believe because you see, but there's going to be people who believe and don't see." And that night changed everything. I mean, I was still a disciple, but now I was an apostle, sent to share the good news, to tell a story. You know, there's another word. And it started with a few of us, began to spread. I think it's the best word of all. It says everything that needs to be said, because we realize it wasn't about how well we believed. It was about who we believed in. Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Yeah, from that moment on, we were called believers.
Believers. What a wonderful term. It reminds us that what we're about is not within ourselves. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in someone else. Thomas is always known and will always be known to be the doubter, doubting Thomas. We've heard that our whole lives. But in Christian tradition, there are churches in India that trace their formation to Thomas's witness and his travels. And so, interestingly, the person known as the doubter probably traveled further sharing his faith than any of the other disciples. It's not about where you are right now or how you feel right now. It's about what God can do through you and to you and with you and in your life. I'm reminded of Martin Luther King Jr., who said, "I'm not what I ought to be. I'm not what I'm going to be. But praise God, I'm not what I'm used to be. I'm not what I used to be." Hopefully we can all say that. Today the message will be about repentance and forgiveness and cleansing. And so I want to read these verses from Psalm 51. If you are wondering how to make a confession and make an apology before God to ask for God's hope and healing and cleansing, Psalm 51 is a fantastic place to start. I want to read these verses. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you alone have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. And in verse 10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Won't you pray with me? Gracious God, as we gather this morning, we're so thankful to be in this place and among these people and among your people. I pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts to your movement. We all can say, create in us a clean heart, renew a right spirit within us. All of us can say, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. I pray that these moments that we have together would be a time that we can all focus upon you and your goodness and your cleansing power. We confess we have tried it our way, and we've tried it our way for a long time in different areas of our lives, maybe even at this moment. And we turn to you, Lord, and we ask for your strength and for your hope and for your healing. We recognize that as we follow Jesus' calling, that he has called us to be agents of reconciliation, people who know what it means to ask for forgiveness, know what it means to receive that forgiveness, people who know what it means to offer it to others and to bring peace and joy and love in this world, all the while pointing to you. But we recognize that is a task we cannot do alone. We know that we need each other. We know that we need you. And so, Lord, we ask for your help. We ask that your light would shine upon our hearts and you would guide our way. And we pray together as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
I want to thank Praise First for the and those in the sound booth for the extra help this week. Brian and Janet and the younger kids are out of town, and so they do a tremendous amount of work to help us get ready for audiovisual and all that. So I want to thank Praise First for all the extra help getting ready for today. And as we were here earlier this morning rehearsing, we wondered how it'd really go, but it's gone okay, so, but anyway, let's have a word of prayer together and reflect upon some of the eternal truth of Scripture. Lord, you are our refuge and strength, the always present help in times of trouble, so we will not fear. Though the mountains quake, though there's water in tumult, we'll be still today, and we will know that you are God. During these moments, may the words of my mouth and may the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. And all God's children said, amen. When I was in graduate school, my theology professor said something that has been something I've wrestled with a lot since then. And of course, I'm 50, so this was like 25 years ago. I don't remember what the context of the conversation was, but he said this. He said, without forgiveness, a person really can't truly live. Without forgiveness, a person really cannot truly live. He said, think about it this way. If you're going to be in relationship with anybody, you're going to have to learn to offer forgiveness, and you're going to have to learn to ask for forgiveness. You're going to have to learn to offer it, and you're going to have to learn to ask for it. Well, I was thinking about that this week as I was thinking some about Psalm 51 and that beautiful passage of David's confession and his asking for cleansing. I was thinking about forgiveness. And I had a conversation with a friend. I listened to a podcast in which she was interviewed. She is a pastor in another state, another denomination, a long way from here. But she was talking with me about this year, and she said, you know, I've had to learn a whole lot about forgiveness. And I said, what? And she said, you know, when I think about, I mean, there have been so many contentious moments in just the world and in society. And you know, in our church, some of us are red and some of us are blue. And she said, every week I've had opportunities to talk about different things. And I have wanted to say my piece, and I've wanted to give my perspective, and I've wanted to respond sometimes with a knee-jerk reaction. But I realize when I look out to people that I don't even agree with on everything, I realize that I love these people, and I want to have a relationship with them. I realize that I need them, and they need me. And so I've had to learn a lot about forgiveness.
I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but sometimes the people that you need to forgive are people that aren't even asking you right now for forgiveness. You know? If you have confessed Jesus as Lord, if you've said, Jesus, I need you to guide my life, I have failed, I want to trust you, please save me, please cleanse me, please guide me. If you have received Jesus' forgiveness, then here is the harder word. More is required of you and me than the culture at large. When it comes to forgiveness, if we have received it, we are required to offer it, to ask for it, to model it. Okay, so that's part one. If you're gonna live in this world, you need to be able to offer forgiveness. But here's the part two. You need to be able to ask for forgiveness. And that's hard to do, is it not? It's so much easier to be in a situation and maybe even catch yourself doing something wrong, but then to say, well, you know, but I'm responding because did you see what she did? I mean, what I did is not half as bad as that. It's real easy to say, well, gosh, I know this isn't exactly right in my heart, and I don't feel the right way, but if you think about it compared to the rest of the world, this really isn't that bad. Or maybe we can say, well, somebody, you know, people are saying, well, you're a good person. I know you've messed up in one area, but you're a great person. We're not being held accountable, and so, you know, it's okay. We need to be able to ask for forgiveness when we've done wrong. And asking for forgiveness looks like this. Interpersonally, it looks like this. I know I have hurt you. I know what I did was wrong. I hurt you with my actions. I know that this has put a barrier between us. I'm sorry that I did that. I'm going to do my best not to do that thing again. And more than that, I'm going to do some other things to help open these boundaries back up. I am sorry. That's what a real apology looks like. Not, well, I know it's bad, but it's not as bad as what everybody else did. And so David is here confronted with his sin. He's confronted with his failure. It is so important to remember in the Psalms, 72 of the Psalms are attributed to David. Okay, that's nearly half of them. There are 150 Psalms. 72 of them have his name at the top. And he prayed some beautiful prayers and sang some beautiful songs. He said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. David prayed that. David sang that. David sang, Lord, you are my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Lord, you are the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? David said that. David said, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, Lord. That's what David said that. But here we see another kind of prayer and another kind of song, and it starts this way. Have mercy on me, O God. If you look in your Bibles and look at the top of Psalm 51, you probably have a note beside that psalm that says something like this. This is a psalm of David when the prophet Nathan came to him after he had gone in to Bathsheba. And that's referring to 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 2 Samuel chapter 12. Now, those are short chapters with a powerful story about this greatest king Israel ever knew, David. And it's a perfect study in how power corrupts, absolute power corrupts. Here's what happens. Just let's brush over it. The chapter 11 of 2 Samuel starts this way. It was the time of year when kings went into battle, but David stayed home. And he sent Joab, his chief officer, and the other generals and the other soldiers into battle, but David stayed in Jerusalem. That's how 2 Samuel chapter 11 starts. And so David, while he stayed home, I don't have enough bookmarks here. I'm looking at two different scriptures. David, while he stayed home, went out on the rooftop, looked out down toward the city, and saw Bathsheba bathing on top of another rooftop. And so here we see absolute power. David sees her, okay, and he could look away. He could say, gosh, okay, he could send word, hey, you know, don't go out that time of day. No, what does he do? He sends someone to inquire, who is that woman? And then, after he finds out who she is and who she's married to, he sends someone to have her come to him. And throughout history, the word Bathsheba has been, we toss that around like that's a kind of a loose woman, a woman of ill repute. Bathsheba, make no mistakes, was absolutely a victim. When the king sent for her, she had no choice but to come. None. The king summoned her, and she came. She got pregnant. She sent word to him that she was pregnant, and then David sent word to her husband to come home, and he said to him, you know, you've been out in battle. Give me an update. He said, you need to go home tonight and rest, and then you go back to the battle. But her husband, Uriah, wouldn't do that. He said, I can't have the comforts of my own home and go to my wife when all of the other soldiers and all the other military people that I'm out with, all the rest of the army, all of them are out sleeping underneath tents out in the open. And so he slept outside. David found out about it. The next night, David said, I want you to come to my house for dinner. David served him dinner. David got him drunk and tried to send him home. See, David was trying to cover for himself, but Uriah wouldn't do it. Uriah stayed outside of his house. And so then David sent for Joab, the top general, and said, Joab, here's what I want you to do. Joab, I want you to put Uriah at the front of the battle, and when things get hot, y'all back up and let him stand there by himself so that he'll die. And sure enough, that's exactly what happened. You know? And so here David, no one's going to hold David accountable. He's a king who can stay home when everybody goes to battle. People loved him. He's the greatest king they ever had. The last verse of chapter 11 says, but the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. 2 Samuel 11, the very last verse. Nobody was going to hold David accountable, but God saw it. God saw it. You know, and if we think about David, we realize he used his power to abuse someone else. He committed adultery. He lied about it. He stayed home when a king was supposed to go to battle. He betrayed his people. He tarnished the throne. He had his generals plot to kill Uriah. David had him murdered. God saw that, and God was displeased. But here's a glimmer of good news. Verse 1 of chapter 12, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. Is there such a thing as messing up so badly and hurting so many people that God is not interested in finding a way to offer forgiveness and redemption and cleansing in your life? Is there such a thing? If there was such a thing, David just did it. But God sent Nathan to David. Poor Nathan. David, I need to tell you a story. There was this man. He was the richest man in the land. He had tons of flocks and sheep. And then there was a poor man who just had one little ewe lamb. One. And this lamb, his family loved it. The lamb stayed in their house. It was like a part of the family. And the rich man had a traveler come to his house. And so the rich man, rather than taking one of his flocks or one of his sheep, the rich man went and took the poor man's lamb, all that he had, and he sacrificed it, and he served it to his guest. David listened to this story, and David is beginning to be incensed. David recognizes, gosh, that is an abuse of power. Can you believe somebody would do something like that? It's not enough to do something just because you can. That's wrong. He had plenty, and he took from somebody who had very little. He didn't care at all. This man deserves to die, and more than that, he deserves to repay the other man four times as much. And do you know what Nathan said? David said, who is this man? And Nathan said, David, you are the man. You are the man. You know, when we sin, that is any time that we do something to hurt someone else, anytime we do something that is wrong, anytime we act on our own authority and for our own interest instead of allowing God to lead the way, and sin makes a barrier in our lives. It makes a barrier between us and the person that we've hurt. It makes a barrier oftentimes between us and the people who are closest to us. You know, it's just like this barrier right there. David felt that barrier with God. The one who said, "The Lord is my shepherd," the one who wrote all these beautiful prayers and sang all these beautiful songs and played these instruments and danced before the Lord, do you think in the time between when he sent for Bathsheba and the time that he was confronted with Nathan, do you think David was able to sing beautiful prayers, play beautiful songs? No matter how many times somebody came to him and said, "David, you're the greatest king Israel's ever had," do you think he ever looked in the mirror and didn't feel this guilt and this shame and this separation from God? I think there was a time when David wasn't able to pray. How can you sing songs about God being your light and salvation when you're hiding something and doing everything you can to cover it up? And all that came to a head when Nathan told him this story. And David recognized, "I am the man. I am the man. I am the one." And that's when David wrote this prayer and sang this song. Once in college, a bunch of us were hanging out in the dorm room like everybody does. We were talking about mutual friends and this, that, and the other, and something came up about one of our mutual friends. And I had not heard what this person had been involved in. And even at a small, you know, Baptist school where everybody's, you know, seems to be kind of halfway facing in the right direction at least, a lot of stuff goes on because people are people and everybody sins. And so this story is told about our friend, and I just said to the guys, I said, "You know, that just surprises me. I didn't think he was the type." And one of my buddies said, "Andy, all of us are the type. Every one of us is the type. We're the type. You're the type." David said, "Who is this?" And Nathan said, "It is you, David." And that's when David made his apology before the Lord. Notice his apology was not, "God, I'm sorry that you were offended by what I did." Notice his apology was not, "Well, I know that was bad, God, but you should see what the other kings are doing." Notice his apology was not, "God, you know, in the big scheme of things, I mean, everything's going to work out all right." His apology was not, "God, would you please let me get off easy? Can you turn the other way?" No, what David said was, "God, I recognize I sinned against you." And then David wrote this, or prayed this, or sang this. "Create in me a clean heart, O God, that I might serve you. Create in me a clean heart, O God, that I might be renewed. So fill me and heal me and bring me back to you. Create in me a clean heart, O God, that I might serve you." David's desire after this broken relationship with God, after this horrible thing he had done, his desire was cleansing and mercy and forgiveness. We're reminded that we can find that forgiveness when we have made mistakes, when we have failed, when we have hurt someone horribly like this was, when we betrayed a country, messed up a throne, when we've even killed, we can find mercy and forgiveness from God. David would find this very thing. His desire was cleansing. I don't know where this strikes you today, but if it's true that without forgiveness a person can't truly live, Maybe today there's somebody that you know you need to offer some forgiveness to. Maybe that person's not asking for it. Maybe that person's not alive anymore, even. Sometimes those are the hardest people to forgive. Perhaps you hear this story and you recognize, I have abused a place that I've been in. Or I've taken advantage of a situation. Or I have depended on others to defend me, and nobody's held me accountable, and I am sorry, and I need to go and tell someone I'm sorry. Maybe there's a barrier between you and someone else. Maybe you need a genuine apology. Perhaps you think about your heart before God and you recognize, I've been going my own way, doing my own thing, and God, I'm sorry. Would you have mercy on me and create in me a clean heart? Would you renew the right spirit within me? John said it this way, if you confess your sins, he is faithful to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. God is big enough to do that. 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. I don't know where this strikes you today, but I really do believe a person cannot live without forgiveness. What if we're called to be agents of reconciliation? What if we're called to accept forgiveness and offer it? What if we're called to be cleansed and lead cleansed and pure and clean lives? What if we're the ones who are asked to set an example of what God's cleanliness can do in a person's life? This is the Psalm of David after that horrible series of mistakes. Have mercy on me, O God. Let's pray. Gracious God, in these moments, we ask you to identify within our hearts the places where we need your mercy and your forgiveness and your grace. We know that in our lives, we need your cleansing. We can't clean ourselves. We can't clean our messes. We can't clean somebody else's messes. But we know, Lord, that you can provide hope and cleansing and healing. You can restore. You can restore our lives. You can restore our attitudes. You can restore the joy in our hearts. And so, Lord, I ask that you would bless this congregation. I pray, Lord, that your mercy would touch each life. And I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a part of the song we sang a few minutes ago, Amazing Grace. And truly, it is God's grace that makes life possible. It's God's grace that provides mercy in our lives and hope and cleansing and forgiveness. And so if you have a decision that you need to make, whether it be in your heart quietly or whether it be in a public way, I'll be here to receive you. But use this time to contemplate this scripture, these words. Pay attention where God's Spirit has touched you this week. Let's sing Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
two reminders of good news. The last verse of 2 Samuel chapter 11, God was displeased with David. But in chapter 12, but God sent Nathan to David. And then 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just and can forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Those are pieces of good news for you and me today. So the charge is receive God's forgiveness, ask for it, receive it, embrace it, seek to understand it as a gift that you couldn't give yourself or anyone else, and then share it with this world. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you and give you peace. Amen.